Jane Taylor to take us through a 1 hour session on belting. So wherever you are, I'll just take you through some technique stuff, okay? So please keep your phones on silent mode. You can snap and share, but just no flash photography. No food and drinks allowed, so please consume them outside. And lastly, I myself will be taking some photos and videos for our social media on Instagram. So if any of you are not comfortable with that, feel free to approach me at any time during the session. So yeah, okay, I'll stop talking and I'll hand the time over to TJ. TJ, please.
So how we use it is completely down to us. So So I'm going to throw how things sound and what things should sound like and what the vowels should sound like and all of these things that we get drilled into us by singing teachers for years and years and years. Throw them outside just for today, okay? Actually, I always believe that we should be open to many, many different styles of singing, especially if you want to go cross-genre. If you are a singer that just wants to sing in one style, of course we have to learn that style very much in detail. But if you want to cross-genre, we have to be open to trying different things and putting our voice in different places. Okay, so that's what I need from you. Do I have agreement?
Yeah.
Fabulous, okay. Now, what is belting? Okay, what is belting? Belting, actually, I'm going to ask you guys, what is belting? Anyone want to put their hand up? What do you think belting is now? Hello, yes.
Singing very loud.
Singing very loud, exactly. Very good. Any more things? Good question. Powerful, loud, powerful, yes. Yes? Pardon? Ad-lib, okay, yes, there can be ad-libs in belting, yes. Riffs and things, yeah. Anything else? Loud enough that you don't need a microphone. I have a microphone, so I'm going to blow all your heads off. But yes, you can be. But that depends on the setting. Because if you're in a stadium, there's no way even Beyonce could belt around Singapore Stadium. Okay, so it really does. So it depends in what sort of context, for sure. But sure, if you are belting, you have to use your microphone differently. So that's actually something I can talk about a little bit later as well. Any more things? Yes?
Supported projection? Is it?
Supportive projection. Okay, we'll come back to that later. Okay, I'll be talking about that later, so we'll unpick that a little bit more later. But I like that terminology. Okay, so yes. Okay, so what is belting? Okay, for me, okay, true belt. Okay, a true belt is that climax or the money belt. Okay, so that's big. If you're watching X Factor, if you're watching Asian Got Talent, or if you're watching any of these modern shows, it's that note that everyone's waiting for. It's coming, and then it goes, bah! And then everyone gets a big round of applause. And I don't know about you, but I feel these days, people often attribute the best singers with the best belters. And people wait for that big belt note, and they go, automatically they're an amazing singer. It doesn't matter for 3 minutes, they've been giving you beautiful sounds for the last 3 minutes. If they've hit that note, they're a really good singer. So these days, especially in modern music and more contemporary music, belting is necessary. If you want to be a contemporary performer in musical theatre, in pop, in more contemporary genres, you have to know how to belt because audiences expect it. Because it's what we all listen out for when we're watching those talent shows. Also, belting has many different sounds. So there is a technical belt. Okay, so I actually most of my training was from Estill. I am not an Estill teacher. I'm not allowed to say I'm an Estill teacher. But that's my background. That's where I trained and how I was trained. So Estill, if you don't know what Estill is, it's very technical. It breaks down the muscles of how we sing. And actually, the Estill version of belting, I'm not going to even touch today because that's one of the things that's now up in the air in terms of how people describe belting. But from a technical perspective, okay, belting has many different sounds. So the pure belt is the technical belt, but we also have things like mix. Have you all heard of mix? Yes, that word gets thrown around quite a lot. So mixing, and we've got lots of different styles of belts, and I'm going to work through a few of them with you today as well, so you can use different styles in different contexts as well. And what styles of music use it? Okay, I want to see what you guys think. So do we think musical theatre uses it? Yes. My background is musical theatre, so a lot of what I'm going to group this in is musical theatre because I feel like that's what I'm an expert at, but I do know a little bit about the other genres as well. I train singers, I don't train musical theatre singers, I try and train across genre as much as possible. Classical singers, do classical singers use it? Okay, interesting, okay. So classical singers, again, they can certainly, we will come back to that later, okay. Rock singers. Jazz?
Yeah.
Okay, folk? Yodelers?
Yes.
Rap? Okay, the fact is, any of the people that sing in those styles are capable of belting. But belting as a quality may not necessarily live in all of those genres that I just spoke about. Okay, so, and I feel like already, let's find out what is belting, first of all. So examples of belting, shall we have a listen? Okay, make sure you're awake, these are very loud, okay? So I want you to tell me, shout out if you know what the song is, and we can have a little quiz as we go through. Okay, so examples of belting. Anyone know what this is from? For example, with my students, I rarely get onto belting until at least, it depends on where they come from, but usually at least 7 or 8 lessons in before I even start attaining the idea of going onto belting. Because there's a lot of foundations that need to be there before we start exploring it. But we can explore it today because I'm going to take it every single time. Okay. The last one, don't belt for long periods of time. It's tiring. It is. Okay, the amount of times I kept singers, okay, we have a little sing, and then they come back a week later, I did everything you said, but you know, it's my voice still went. And I was like, but how long did you practice? Oh, I did like 4 hours practice. Well, 4 hours of big loud sounds is gonna tire your voice out. So it's about being your own doctor, it's about being safe, it's about knowing what you're doing. It's like anything. If I go to the gym and lift like 60 kg, I'm probably gonna pull a muscle. Okay, so you've got to build yourself up and you've got to work up these muscles and get to the right place so you can really explore it safely, especially if you're putting it into song. Okay, those are my rules, okay? No one's gonna break them. $500 fine. Okay, here we go. Now, I love this sentence. If it hurts, it's wrong. That goes with anything in life, okay? Again, my funny memes, okay? Enjoy the memes for a second. Okay. We've probably all seen things like this. The sound of If you are ever losing your voice when you're exploring any style, this isn't just belting, okay? Even if you're trying your classical aria or your musical theatre ballad, if you are losing your voice, your body is telling you something. Your body is saying, hello, you're doing something wrong. Something is getting in the way. Because the amount of times singers will come to me and go, oh, I can sing this song, but when I practice the end, I lose my voice. Well, you know, there's something, something is wrong there, so we need to have a look at how that's fixed. And so many singers go through years and years and they go, oh, I can sing, but I always get raspy the next day. Every single day I get raspy. Again, you're not utilizing your technique in the correct way if your body is like telling you, oh, you're in pain every single time you sing. So please just keep that in mind. Just like anything, if I went for a run and I kept pulling my leg, I would probably stop running. So just be aware of that and listen to your body if it's telling you that something is wrong. Okay. Right, we're going to warm up. Okay, so I'm going to give you my kind of pre-warm up. Now, just to get a chance to show of hands, I just want to know who's in the room. So do we have anyone that's in a choir? Anyone that's in a choir? Couple of people, yes, okay. Any pop singers? Pop singers? Yeah. Okay. Musical theatre singers? Yes. Okay. Put your hands up, be proud about it. Okay, good. I'm not gonna make you do a solo, don't worry. Okay. Prove it. Jazz singers. Any jazz singers? Wonderful. Any classical singers? Have I already asked that? I can't remember. Fabulous. Okay. So we've got a wide variety. Any singing teachers? Hello? Hello. okay, so just to kind of get an idea. So this warm-up that I'm going to give you today is kind of a pre-warm-up. So whenever I'm in a choir or whenever I'm in a group, often a warm-up involves what? What does a warm-up involve? Scales, okay, yes. Usually that's an answer I get straight away. Okay, so I'm warming up, I'm going to do scales. Who does scales to warm up? Yes, okay. Hopefully most of your hands went up. Scales are important. Scales are very, very important. But scales are not a warm-up in themselves, okay? Depending on the scale, okay? So the warm-up I'm going to give you is thinking about how do we warm up the muscles to get ready for scales. Because realistically, la 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 is exactly the same as singing, okay? Because it's exactly the same. There's no difference, okay? But what we want to do before that is very important. So this is the pre-warm-up that I'm going to give you, okay? So, what's in a warm-up? Okay, so safety, very important, okay? So we want to warm up because we want to be safe when we're singing. So just like any exercise, if you're going to the gym or if you're going to go to a dance class, we're going to warm up our body, okay? So that's very, very important that we are safe when we're singing. Okay, preparation. I love a warm-up just by preparing yourself in the space. It takes your mind off all the things, all your stresses at work, all of your frustrations with your partner, and all of this. Okay, it takes your mind off and putting you in that space ready to sing. And finally, musicality. So that's where the scales come in. Okay, so that's where the scales come in. That's the training of the ear. That's the training of how you are going to develop your musicianship. Okay, but most importantly, a warm-up is a stretch. Again, if you don't like memes, I'm sorry, you're going to hate this presentation. Okay. Okay. So, a warm-up is a stretch. Just like I said, if you're going to the gym, before I go and I do all of my things, I'm going to stretch out my muscles. This is a pre-warm-up stretch that if you're in a choir, you can do this before you go to a choir. Because when I lead a choir, I don't have time to do this warm-up because I've got to get straight up with it and I've got to bring my singers together and scales and arpeggios, and those are the things that bring people together. But as a singer, you want to prepare your voice by stretching all the muscles needed to get that voice working. And if we're going to belt, I want to give you this little bit of a preparation warm-up so we can all belt safely later, okay? So I'm going to break this down into little sections. This is specifically for helping us belt today. You can use this for anything, actually. You can use this if you're a teacher or even if you're just doing a presentation at work. It's a really great little warm-up just to get your voice warm and your muscles warm. Okay, so that's kind of the warm-up we're doing today. We're not going to be doing any scales and arpeggios for now, but they do have their purpose in other genres and other styles. Okay, number one is body. Okay, again, cute cat me. Okay, so let's all stand up if you want to warm up. If you don't want to stand up, that's absolutely fine, don't worry. Okay, wonderful, okay. So, we are going to singing is a full body exercise. Singing is a full body exercise. It's really, really important to know that. Because the amount of times I get singers that come in and they go, la, and they're like, I can't sing. Okay, so we have to warm up our body. And also, can you all just tense your butt for me? Really tense it. Squeeze, squeeze, squeeze. Okay, straight away, it affects all the other muscles. So whenever there's tension in your body, tension travels. So it tenses your voice, and that's why we have to kind of wake all the muscles. Okay, release your butt. Okay, so we want to get all the muscles warm. So first things first, we are all the generation we're using our mobile phones. So straight away, shoulders and neck always are stressed because we're all on the MRT doing this. Okay, so we're just going to roll our shoulders first. So keep roll. Okay, try and get into almost meet in the middle of the back. That's kind of where you want it to go. Enjoy this really kind of a bit slower, don't go too fast. Again, focus your warm-up. This is really important. So many people come to my studio and they go, oh, I've got a 35-minute warm-up routine. Who's got time for that? No one's got time for 35 minutes of warm-up. Okay, so this is a very specific warm-up aimed at trying to warm up the muscles specific for singing. So we're now going to go. Okay, put them around your ears. This is a good work for everyone. I might take a picture. This could be my next meme for my next meme. And release your shoulders. Good. One more time. Just because it's funny. Okay. And down. Okay, good. Shake them out. Okay, now just roll your neck and your head for me. Nice and gentle. If you feel any spots where it's a little bit tight, okay, you can spend a little bit of time there and just stretch it out. However you need to go, any way you like. Good, okay, now feet shoulder width apart. Okay, now, I'm sure as singers the all of posture is very, very important. One little thing that I constantly seem to correct quite a lot, whether you're a singer for a short time or a long time, is so many people have their feet too close together. And as soon as that happens, you're using more of your muscles to try and stand up, so there's already a little bit of tension in your body. And same if you're apart, you're already stretching your muscles. So we want to be really shoulder width apart, so a nice little V, so we can stand up nice and tall. Okay, so then lengthen the spine. Okay, don't stick your bum out, you may be unsafe. Okay? Okay, and just keep it nice and tucked in. Okay, so we're nice and warm. Fabulous. Okay, so this I call active standing. Okay, so we don't want to lock, okay, so you don't want to lock anything. But you also don't want to be loose, okay? So it's just, I'm ready to go. I'm giving a presentation. Oh, I am. Okay. Okay, you just want this active standing. This is enough for most singing, except for belting. Okay, we're going to come back to that later. Okay, so, moving on. Okay, so we've got our body. Our body is awake now. What should we do after we stretch our body? Okay, what's the next thing? There it is. Breathing. Okay, now, breathing. Okay. As singers, breathing is a word that everybody uses and everyone panics about. And as soon as we sing, suddenly we have to change our breathing. So we go, I've got to get more breath in, I've got to do so many things, I've got to support, I've got to use all these words. I ain't going to talk about breathing today. I'll explain why as we go along. But so many people get locked in how they should breathe. So the only thing I'm going to talk about breathing is I'm going to let everything go for me. Can you breathe out for me? No tension, don't tense anything. Let it all out. And just a natural breath in. That's all I want to do. Breathe out. Let it all go. Don't take a singing breath. Breathe in. And out. Breathe in. And out. And in. Your body already knows how to breathe. If it didn't, we'd be carting you out to a new age. Okay? Okay, your body already does this automatically. Okay? Your breathing mechanism already kicks in. Just because we're singing, suddenly we don't have to add some mystery science to things. Especially if we're belting. Because belting is an extension of talking in so many ways. Okay, and we're going to get onto that a little bit later. But breathing-wise, do not take in those nice big deep abdominal breaths that we talk about in so many of the styles, which are important for other styles. I'm not saying you younger, so you're a singing teacher. Well, I went to this workshop, and you said that I should do this when I'm doing my classical aria, because they'll be like, no, and I would also be no, okay? So make sure anything you learn is in context of what you're learning it with. Students often get caught up, and then you copy and paste things to lots of other things. So I just want to put that as a little warning now. So the next thing we're going to talk about, I'm skipping over breathing. In a normal lesson, when I'm teaching a full lesson for students, we would focus a little bit more on breathing. Okay, but for today, that's the maximum I need for you for today for breathing. And that gives me a few questioning faces, and I can't wait to explain it. Okay, so next is sirens. Have you ever done kind of sirens before? No, it's not those. Okay, sirens. Can you all, if you know what a siren is, we're all going to do it together, can you demonstrate to me what you think a siren is, okay? Because I know a lot of teachers use them. Okay, can we all siren together? Ready? 3, 2, 1. Ooh. Lovely. Okay, so that might have jumped a few people's memories. So let's try our siren, what we think it might be. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Okay, do you have a big gulp for me? Mm-hmm. You feel something move? Okay, I hope you all do. Okay. Okay, one more time, big gulp. Okay, if you're a guy, your Adam's apple will be pushing against your hand. Okay, girls, you'll also feel it too, but just not quite as pronounced. So that is your larynx. It moves vertically, it goes up and down, and it also goes forward and back. So it's got this motion, it moves up and down and forward and back. Okay? And we're gonna focus on this because you can put your hands down. Because if we're going to warm up the voice, okay, and we use the larynx a lot for singing, because what's inside of the larynx? The vocal cords, or the vocal folds, very good. Okay, so the vocal folds are inside the larynx, okay? So, those are the things that make the sound. So, the faster they vibrate, the higher the sound, the slower they vibrate, the lower the sound, okay, in terms of pitch, okay? That's the pitch. So, if we want to warm up the muscles for singing, we want to stretch those muscles very specifically. So la 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 la, la 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 la, my larynx moved this much. That much. Whereas if we do this exercise, we're going to stretch it all the way through this, all the way through the register. Okay. So at the siren, we're going to use an N sound. Okay, a lot of people and a lot of literature talks about the NG sound. People have moved away from the NG sound because the G sound drops your tongue and it also sits on top of your larynx and causes some pressure. So if you know about the NG sound, I've stopped using that now, and a lot of teachers have, and we start using the N sound because it keeps your tongue up. Okay, so just for the teachers in the room, a little bit of voice geekery. Okay, so N sound, so you just go, This is very loud, it's just like that cat that we saw in the body. Okay, so, Okay, just a tiny, tiny sound, and then maybe even quieter. Really small. That is the sound. Can you hear how it's made? Like, there's 100 people doing that sound, and it is very, very, very quiet. It's not very, very different. It has a very different effect. So whenever you're working something more intricately, again, I always use the example of the gym. I've just gone back to the gym, so I'm feeling it. Okay, so if you work something slower and you're working it very slowly, you're going to impact that muscle a little bit more. Rather than going, yay, I'm lifting weights. Yay. Okay. So that's what the big siren is doing. Okay. So this small siren is going to really intricately warm up the muscles that we need to get the vocal folds working. So that end sound, we're going to all explore all of our ranges at different pitches at different times. It's going to sound like a hot mess, but each individual person is doing their own warm up. So on an end sound, explore your whole register. Right now, nobody's going past about C, okay? I know you've all got much more range than that. Okay, so let's just all sound really high this morning. Okay, we're going Because what that does is it mirrors the action of the larynx. Because the larynx is going up, it's tilting, it's coming back around, and it goes down. So that one little trick helps you get that tilt, okay, as we go up. Okay, so let's all try that one more time. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Okay, so we have to make sure we go right into those high notes to feel the effect. So we'll go one more time. 3, 2, 1.
Exactly the same. Okay,
say it again. I like to feel what happens. Working really, really hard, the rest of the body wants to support it. The rest of it, kind of, we want that good foundation. I always term it as if you're in a lift shaft, and the lift shaft is made of jello or it's made of concrete. Okay? If we're going up and we're working so intricately, we'd rather have concrete than jello, for sure. Okay? But sometimes jello's nice when we want to just kind of relax, okay? And actually, and sometimes, you know, it's fine, we don't need to necessarily use as much effort. Okay, but in belting, we want to have a good foundation so all of this can do its job. So even in your seats, you can do this just for now. Okay, I just want you to lift up from your neck for me. Look down. And then you can feel the kind of neck muscles have engaged a little bit now as you look down. Now look up, just keeping those muscles engaged. Don't let them go. Okay, so you kind of sit in a bit more upright. I don't want you to tense, so you shouldn't feel extra tension kind of going in anywhere else. We're just engaging this part here. Okay, already, now we have that concrete lift shaft, so the larynx can move up and down, and it's got that support. It's there. Those muscles are helping it. Okay, just by doing that. One more time. Lift up. Okay, look down. Good. So this is kind of the foundation there. Only like a level 5 or 6. When I first learned belting, you can let that go. When I first learned belting, teachers used to say you have to use like level 10 effort, and you have to really kind of use all of your body. And actually the science has changed on that, because that then affects things in other ways. So you only have to just engage it just a little bit, like kind of medium level, somewhere in between. Just to give you just enough so the larynx can do as well. Next is more anchoring. Okay, so I want you all, you can probably do this sat down. We'll try doing this sat down. I like to imagine you've got two soccer balls under your arms, okay? But you all wish you put deodorant on. Okay, so now you're just going to squeeze together. So you're just going to feel your latissimus dorsi at the back. They're just going to come together just a little bit there. Okay, again, not affecting anything around the front. Okay, just at the back, we're just keeping that anchoring at the back there. And again, whenever you see this. Okay, relax. It's not just to look good. Okay, you don't just do it to make it look impressive. It actually does. And a lot of the positions help it look even more impressive than it actually is. The minimum we need to do, engage this, engage this. If I belted a big impressive note at the end of the song and just did this, you'd be like, oh. Okay. So often as singers, we make it look harder than it actually is. Okay, it's a technique. Okay. So, especially in the end of the song, pop singers often go, but you'll never see them do this. Crunch all the muscles that we actually need to use to sing. Okay, so it's very important to still keep that posture, especially around here. Okay, moving on. Surprise breath. Okay, so I'll keep you sat down. You stood up for a little while, but make sure you're sitting up in your seats. Okay, so breathe out for me. Let everything go. Everything, 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 everything. Now a little surprise breath. Okay, already I've heard too many people do too much breath. Okay, breathe out. It's a surprise breath, and actually you're allowed to let it go a little bit higher. So if you've always learned abdominal breathing, this is going to feel very odd. Okay, so just a little bit higher. That is as much breath as you need to belt most phrases. Always a jaw drop moment. Okay, it really is, and I'll tell you why. Okay, it's going back to these lovely little vocal folds. In belting, my vocal folds are thick. Okay, so when my vocal folds are thick, if I take a big, huge breath, and this is true belt, there are other styles of belt, but in a true belt, if my vocal folds are this thick, and I put lots of breath at them, they're going to crash open, okay? And if you've ever tried to belt, and you've cracked on it, and you go, and it opens up like that, you probably use too much breath, okay? And as a good example, put too much breath, okay, and the vocal folds don't let the breath through. So what it causes traffic. It causes pressure underneath the vocal folds, which pushes against it and then causes the vocal folds to do things that they don't want to do. So then they'll latch together or they might scrape together, and that's where you're probably going to get a sore throat, okay? Because you're putting too much breath there. Whereas, if you just give it a little bit of breath, okay? Just a little bit of breath. Then it can do its job. Okay, they can do their job. They can vibrate this thickly, okay? So this is the number one thing that people often do when they start to belt, especially if you come from styles that tell you to take a big, huge breath, okay? It actually only needs a little bit, because from a muscular perspective, that is anatomically how we can get those sounds, okay, for belting, okay? That's just based on science. Okay, finally, surprise position. Okay, so not only do we have a surprise breath, the larynx as well. Okay, it's different in different types of belts. I'll talk about this later, but for the true belt, okay, we want to get this kind of surprise from the pitch. Can anyone act surprised? Where does the larynx go? Up, a little bit up, okay? So this surprise breath and the surprise position up here is exactly what we need for belt. And even just talking now, you can hear how much thicker my voice has become, okay, just by doing this position. So can you all just say, surprise, breathe out. Little surprise with a surprise breath in here. Hello.
Hello.
Hey.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello.
Uh-oh.
Hello.
Hey.
Hey.
Anyone's feeling cracky? It's too much breath, okay? If anyone's cracking on that, breathe out. Well, already you're sounding much better, breathe out. We're going to raise it in pitch just a little bit. You all just moved your false vocal folds. Congratulations. Your body already knows how to do this. Okay, air only has a sound when it passes something. Okay, just like wind, if it passes a tree, it gets louder. Okay, same with your false vocal folds. So your false vocal folds already know how to move in and out. So when we're belting, we want to get a happy position. Okay, so can you all just smile for me? Now breathe out. Any sound? No? Okay. Now, a silent laugh. Just go. Breathe out. Any sound? No. So we have a nice, smooth airway. Okay, we have a nice, smooth passage for air to pass through. So again, when we're belting, we don't want anything in the way. We're working far too hard when we're belting for anything to come in the way. So we want to get that happy feeling as well. So we've got anchoring, we've got surprise breath, surprise position, and also a big happy smile as well, which the surprise position usually does as well. But these are things that often get in the way that I'm trying to get here. Right, we're going to try something out now. Okay, can we all stand up? If you want to join in, come with me. If you don't know anyone, make friends with someone next to you. Okay, say hello. Oh my gosh, I'm going to talk to a stranger. Okay, if there's not any people around, that's okay. You can share. May, hello May. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to make friends with this person, okay? So we're going to practice our belts doing this. So what we and May are going to do is I'm going to shake our hand. That's okay, we're going to shake our hand. Okay, but we're going to shake our hand quite firmly. Okay, so we feel our lats kind of engaged, the thing we were just talking about. I'm just going to go, we're surprised to see each other. Hey!
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 How are you? Good, so this is how we're going to talk, okay? We're going to have a little conversation, okay? Then usually there's a drop when we come back down to the verse, then we build up again to a little chorus, then we'll drop again, and then we'll go up to a big belt, usually, and then it usually drops off straight away. Why? Because whenever we're emotionally excited and we're at the top of our emotion, then, I'm so angry with you, I can't believe what you've done! Usually, although we don't stay in that vocal effort and that emotional effort for so long, okay, so good musical theatre writing follows that emotional effort. You notice I say good musical theatre writing. Bad doesn't. But same with pop as well, also in pop. But pop, in a 4-minute song, we have to condense a whole journey. In musical theatre, it's part of a bigger journey, it's part of a narrative over 2 hours. In pop, Adele's only got 3 minutes to sell that song to you. So she's got to put more in to make it more exciting over those 3 minutes, okay? So she might belt a little bit more, and that journey might look very different. Okay, this is kind of a musical theatre journey that you're seeing up here. Okay, I'm going to talk about some different stuff. Mixing. Oh, that word. Okay. As a teacher now, I really hate using words. People get locked up in them so many times, and they go, I need to use my chest voice for this sound. Or I need to use my head voice, or I need to use this, or I need to use that. And they're constantly coming in going, but is this my chest voice or my head voice? Is this, what is this? I don't know what this is. Well, if it's working for you, why do we need to name it? Okay? We don't necessarily need to name it, so long as you can repeat it. Okay? And sometimes these words, even the words I use from it still, you know, the still language, the speech quality, the cry quality, and those words, I've even kind of, I get very catchy about using them because students, we hang a lot of things on these words, especially if you use the head and chest voice words. Okay? Because people put, as earlier, what I said, we don't have a voice in our head and we don't have a voice in our chest. We have a larynx and a set of vocal folds that can move up and down. Okay? And it might sound heady or might sound chesty, but often people get them confused and you get so wrapped up in your head about what this word is and where it is. And belting especially, it's like, well, do I use my chest, my head, another? Each can be on their own. And also with belting, there's many different styles, which is what I'm going on to. So mixing, okay. You only belt the money note, okay? That true belt that we just did, you want maybe one or two notes in the song like that, okay? Because it's exhausting, okay? And often, singers don't even use it, okay? So the amount of times you go to the West End and they've got to do 8 shows a week, and you're like, I'm not going to belt 8 shows a week. I need some other options, you know? I went out for a drink last night. I can't belt tonight, okay? So as singers, we need other options as well that are a little bit easier. Okay, so mixing is what we call speech and twang. So this is a very Estillian way of describing it. But can you still go, uh-oh?
Uh-oh.
Now I'm going to add a bit of twang. So you just go, yay! More belting in classical, okay? Or supportive projection, as I think the lady over there used earlier, okay? So a little bit more supportive projection. Whereas a true belt, and when we're using the term belt and what it anatomically means, it's what we were learning earlier. Okay? You get the difference?
Yeah?
Okay. Okay, I don't have time for any demonstrations, but we kind of all demonstrated, and I've just demonstrated a little bit for you there. And I'm going to give like maybe a couple of minutes to questions, because again, I don't want to keep you all night, I'm already running over. But does anyone have any questions? Don't be shy. Again, if I've completely contradicted what you've ever learned, I love it. Yes?
I'm still tired.
How do you practice belting? It's like anything, you know, again, you know, you go to the gym, you wouldn't do an hour, you know, you wouldn't do 3 hours of gym training. You build yourself up, so you also have to build up the stamina. So, you know, those muscles need time to get used to being thicker, especially if you don't use them very much. So, I often say to my students, actually, because it comes from speaking so much, practice using a more connected speech. So, in Singapore especially, I find a lot of gym, depending on how we speak, sometimes we speak softer because that's how we've grown up. Or it depends on where we've grown up, but if you want to get that kind of practice in, you can practice every day just by connecting your sound a little bit more. And that will seriously help your singing, because you do that a lot more than you sing. Okay? So that's one way you can do it. But when you are practicing belting, it's about resting, it's about taking breaks, okay? And also not focusing on that one note. Because going back to the idea of building up the song, the build-up is just as important as the belt. If we don't build up to it in the right way, we're never going to get it. So just by going, hey, 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 over and over again, it's just going to get tired. Okay? So it's just about pacing yourself, and that build-up is just as important. So usually if the belt's not working, I'll go back maybe 12 bars and go, right, how did we work up to that belt? Okay, maybe can we get into that belt? Yeah. Technically, okay. Again, this is I could do a whole workshop on mixing as well. But the speech and timing. So the speech is your thicker vocal folds, okay, but not as thick as belting. So in belting, the vocal folds thicken. And I was going to talk about, they talk about the cricoid tilting, okay, but there's now science that says that the cricoid doesn't quite do what they just thought it was going to do. So I was going to explain it in those terms, but I don't want to get into that kind of worms because it really is a huge debate in the voice science world at the moment. But with thick vocal folds and a lot of twangs, what twang does is it thins out the space. So you imagine the vocal tract, it gets smaller, and then as that air comes through, it gets condensed, just like a condenser microphone. So it all goes through, and naturally it gets louder, which is why babies are very loud. Yeah! They love twang, okay? So that's how babies project, okay? And that twang mechanism gives us that volume already. Whereas belt, we don't use as much twang. We use the pure vocal folds, which is because the twang takes some of that pressure off. That makes sense? Yeah. Okay, again, I would love to go to audio, but if I do, I'm going to give you a bit too much information and then you're not going to notice it. Okay, yes? Yes, it lives a little bit higher generally, so it's usually around the kind of mid area for guys. So usually guys start belting, pure belting, from around, depending if you're a lower voice, from about an E. And all the way up to some guys can belt up to a C. But generally, belting for most guys is around F, F sharp, G, G sharp, A, that sort of area in most songs. And girls usually start belting kind of from an A through to a D or an E. But again, some people can belt a little bit higher, a little bit lower. So it usually lives in that in between the mix in between the head and chest voice, if we're going to use those terms. Okay, so that kind of middle area. Because that's where it's most exciting. Why? Because excitement, all of these qualities we talk about with the emotion, the excitement is when we're on the edge. So if we put our voice in that place where it's not comfortable, it's not in the thick folds and it's not in the thin folds, that's where our voice sounds the most exciting. Okay, so that's where belting is truly. Okay. Maybe two more questions. Okay, so often sometimes when we speak, so some people have a voice like something kind of like a voice like this, and they go, I don't know how to belt. Can you help me belt? You don't speak in the speech pattern generally in the day-to-day. So if you're not fully connecting your vocal folds there, you're already keeping your speech open. So if we bring our vocal folds together with thick vocal folds, that's not to say everyone has to sound like this. Not at all. Okay, not at all. But especially if I came in today and said, hi everyone, my name is TJ, and I'm going to do this presentation, I'm going to come across in a very different way. Okay. Whereas if I come across with thick vocal folds, I get your attention and I get your command. So especially, it's a good interview thing, it's not just the singing. You go in an interview, hello, I'd like a job. Hello, I don't like a job. I'm very good at what I do, and if it's not coming across properly, it's coming across confidence. Okay, so by using that connected speech quality every day, you can practice and you can get your singing technique better, not only your speaking voice. Any more questions? One more, maybe? Yes, it's okay. Honestly, so my background is more contemporary, so I try not to get into debates with classical and contemporary, because I don't pretend to have gone through classical training for years and years and years and years. But what I'm saying is earlier where the placement is, if it's further back, anatomically, it's going to cause some pressure, okay? So if I'm in a belt in E, it's the worst vowel in the world to belt, okay? But I want to place, actually, I'll go back to my slides here. Okay, if I want to place that E, okay, I want to place it further forward. So E, because it gets too tight like that, so I want to bring it forward. So forward. E, yeah, I believe that Lord God created the universe. I believe. I want to place it forward. Whereas if I go, I believe, it's going to get tight, it's going to get tense. So basically, what I do, how I think about it, is if you've seen this kind of placement shot before, imagine that let me go there, I just bring all of that
enjoyed today's workshop. We'll give you another round of applause for being here.